In this lesson, we'll study torque, a way to measure if a force causes an object to rotate. We'll look at a few examples of rotating objects, but build our understanding by pushing, pulling, and applying force to a rotating door at different angles. Together, we'll reveal all the factors that affect torque and use that to slowly build an equation to calculate it. If physics has taught us anything, it's that force creates acceleration. Your car gets stalled on the side of the road, apply a force to make it move and accelerate. Playing tennis, hit the ball with force to make it change its motion. But there are some forces that not only cause acceleration, but also rotation. Force on a wrench can cause it to rotate, turning a bolt. A force applied to a bike wheel makes it spin. And a force applied to a door can make it open. A force that causes rotation generates torque, which is basically just a rotational force that creates rotational motion. To study torque, we'll start with an example of a rotating object you see every day. One that's just constantly getting in your way, a door. You probably know how a door works. Apply a force and the door opens or closes. But it's actually not that simple. To cause rotational motion, the force we apply has to have certain properties. To see that, let's look at the door from above. Here's a door, attached to a set of door hinges. The hinges define the axis of rotation, or the line around which the door will rotate. Returning to the top view, if we apply a force by pushing on the door, it begins to accelerate and rotate. Okay, that makes sense. But if instead we pushed harder with greater force, the door rotates faster. Okay, still no surprises there. Push a door harder and it accelerates more. But now let's try something else. Instead of applying the force far from the hinges, let's apply it close to the axis of rotation. Even if we push with the same amount of force, the door will accelerate more slowly. Okay, that's a little surprising. If you're near a door, you can try it yourself. It's harder to cause rotation when the force is applied closer to the axis of rotation. Let's look at one final variable that affects the ability of a force to generate torque and rotation. So far, we've only applied forces to the door that are perpendicular to R. So if we project or draw a dashed line from R to represent its direction, the angle of the force so far has always been 90 degrees. But what if we applied force in a different direction, like directly towards the axis of rotation? This would be like pushing on a door directly towards the hinges. In this case, the angle theta would be 180 degrees, and what would you expect the door to do? Try it for yourself. We'll wait. And you're back. It did not rotate. What if instead we applied the same force, but now directly away from the axis of rotation? This would be like if we grabbed the end of a door and pulled on it directly away from the hinges. In this case, the angle theta would be zero, and again, the door will not rotate. But if we apply the force at certain angles, the door will now rotate. So the angle of the force matters. Breaking down the force into its parallel and perpendicular components, only the force component perpendicular to R generates rotation. Any part of the force that is in line with R does not produce torque or rotation. Using some trigonometry, the magnitude of this perpendicular component is equal to F sine theta. So, the ability of a force to generate torque and rotation depends on three things. One, the magnitude of the force. Two, the distance from the rotational axis. And three, the angle at which the force is applied. Putting it all together in an equation, we see that the torque tau is equal to the distance from the axis of rotation r times the perpendicular component of the force, which is equal to F sine theta. By the way, since r is measured in meters, and F is measured in newtons, torque has the standard SI units of newton meters. Also, by old-timey tradition that's been around forever, torque is considered positive when the rotation is counterclockwise and negative when the rotation is clockwise. Finally, while we've only looked at one force being applied, an object can experience many forces and many torques at once. When multiple forces are applied, each force could possibly create a different torque on the object. To see if the torque will rotate, we'll need to add up all of the forces and all of the torques. The sum of the individual torques is called the net torque, or tau net. If the net torque is zero, meaning all the individual torques have canceled each other out, the object will not change its rotation. If it's not rotating, it's not going to start rotating. If it is rotating, it will continue rotating at that exact same angular speed. Nothing will change. And that's torque for you. We learned that forces that produce torque create rotational motion, and that torque depends on three factors: the magnitude of the force, or how hard we push or pull, the angle at which it's applied, and the distance from the rotational axis, or how close the force is to the axis of rotation. Think about this equation next time you open a door. And if you want to make that door swing open fast, don't forget to keep your R high, your angle perpendicular, and that force nice and strong. In the next lesson, we'll learn about the relationship between torque and the angular acceleration produced by that torque.